Hello, so this is the second video in the Ankylosing Spondylitis series. In this video, we will basically discuss about how to diagnose for the Ankylosing Spondylitis. So we will discuss the various symptoms, signs, various investigation, various imaging techniques, and the various diagnostic criteria used for the Ankylosing Spondylitis. So please refer to the introductory video to the Ankylosing Spondylitis part 1, which is already in the list before watching this video. So to begin this video, we will first discuss about the symptoms. So most common symptom the patient presents is the chronic low backache. And the various specifications is the, first is the low backache is the morning stiffness. So patient will complain that he or she is having low backache, which is more in the morning and associated with the stiffness. Plus, there is not an acute onset of the pain. It is an insidious increase in the pain. So, most common complaint will be of the chronic low backache with the morning stiffness, insidious onset. And the most, in epidemiology, we have already discussed the age group. It is the third age group that this type of pain, it begins. So, another complaint, the patient might complain is the buttock pain because of the sacroiliitis. Then we can have the complaint of shortness of breath because of the reduced chest expansion due to costochondritis. Then patient may complain of the various enthesiopathies, which we have already discussed the what all the sites are involved. So enthesis is basically the bony attachment of the ligament and the tendons. So the various sites that are involved in case of ankylosing spondylitis are these. So most common is the first costochondral joint, seventh costochondral joint, posterior spiral iliac spine, anterior spiral iliac spine, iliac crest, fifth lumbar spinous process, proximal insertion of the Achilles tendon and the plantar fascia insertion. So patient may complain of pain or swelling in all these regions. So as the deformity advances, patient may complain of a loss of the horizontal gaze. The patient may present with the chin on chest deformity with the loss of the horizontal gaze. So these were few of the various symptoms with which the patient may present to us. So most common is the low backache and the buttock pain. Now the various signs that we will be checking in the patient. So first is the various mobility test. So in mobility test, we have the classified into lumbar, thoracic and the cervical. So in lumbar, we will go for the Schauber's test and the modified Schauber's test. Then we can go for the finger to floor distance. We can go for the lateral flexion, lumbar lateral flexion. So beginning with the Schauber's test. So Schauber's test. So this is the Schauber's test. So in this patient is standing upright and two marks are made. One is at the level of the sacral dimples and another is at the 10 centimeter proximal to it. So we ask the patient to bend forwards. So if the overlying skin stretches to 15 cm, it is normal. Any value less than this indicates a reduced lumbar mobility. A modification of this test is the modified Schauber test, in which the points marked are 2. So we mark for the sacral dimples, then we mark a point which is 10 cm above it and a point which is 5 cm below it. So total of 15 cm line is marked and with the flexion there should be increase from 15 cm to at least 20 cm. Any distance less than 5 cm is considered abnormal. So this was about the Schauber's test. Now the other tests that are used for the mobility checkup for the lumbar spine is the finger to floor test. We ask the patient to bend forward without bending the knees and we check for the finger to floor distance. Now coming upon to the other test, we have the thoracic mobility, we have a chest expansion. So basically the values of chest expansion are defined for every age group, but normally the chest expansion is more than 5 cm. So it is taken from deep inspiration to deep expiration, and normal values is the chest expansion of 5 cm. So any value or any chest expansion that is less than 2 cm is favoring our diagnosis toward the ankylosing spondylitis. So for the cervical mobility, we have the occipital to wall distance, tragus to wall distance, and the cervical rotation. So this is the occipital to wall distance. So normally it should be 0, and this distance is calculated. Then we have the tragus to wall distance, which is similar to occipital to wall distance. It is calculated from tragus to wall. Other is the cervical rotation. And last, to check for the hip mobility, we have the intermalleolar distance. So intermalleolar distance is checked between the two malleoli, and normally it is more than 100 cm. So this was about the mobility test, the various mobility tests that can be done. Then, as bilateral sacroiliitis is one of the common feature, we will go for the SI joint test. So we have number of SI joint tests. The most common of them is the Faber test or the Patrick test. We make a figure of 4 of the affected limb. So this limb is, this leg is flexed, abducted, and externally retracted. So we make a figure of 4. So if there is a pain, this comes out to be a positive Patrick test or the Faber test. Another important test is the Gansland test or the pump handle test. So in this, patient is supine, hip joint is flexed maximally, and the other hip joint is extended, and force is applied over the both the hip joint. So if the positive, if there is a pain felt across the SI joint. Other tests used, we have the SI joint distraction test. So we cross our arms and we apply distractive and external rotation force over the bilateral hip. So this is the SI joint distraction test. Then we have the SI joint compression test. So we, in the lateral position, we apply a compressive force over the SI joint, and the patient will experience pain if there is SI joint involvement. So after the signs, we have the various lab investigations that can be done. We have the ESR-CRP that will be mostly elevated in this patient. Rheumatoid factor will be negative, as it is seronegative spondyloarthropathy, and HLA-B27 will be positive in about 95% of the patients. And coming upon to the imaging techniques, so most common is the X-ray. So we have the various views of the X-ray. For the axial spine, we will go for the full length AP and the lateral view. So for the axial spine, we will go for the full length AP and lateral view. So what all will be seen on the X-ray? So first, so as this is the sequence of events that occur in the axial spine in ankylosing spondylitis. So first of all, there will be a loss of lordosis. It will be followed by a diffuse osteoporosis, and then a reactive sclerosis, followed by ossification of the various ligaments. So as we can see, there is ossification of the various ligaments. There is ossification of the outer fiber of annulus fibrosis. There is syndesmoid formation. So this is the various sequence of events. So normally the edges will be sharp, To begin with, there will be erosion and the edges will look like eroded. Then there can be sclerosis of the edges to again form a pointed end. A much pointed end is known as obvious syndesmophytes are formed. And in the later stage, a total bony bridge is formed. So this was about the various findings on the apolateral x-ray of the exospine. Important finding is the bamboo spine, which is because of the fusion vertebral body fusion by the marginal syndesmophytes anteriorly, and it is accompanied by the fusion of the posterior elements as well. So it basically involves the thoracolumbar and the lumbosacral junction. Another finding we have is the squaring of vertebras. So this is early radiographic finding of squaring of vertebras. Then coming upon to the SI joint x-rays, we have a Ferguson pelvic tilt view. So in Ferguson pelvic tilt view, we go for a 15 to 20 degree of cephaloid angulation to look for the SI joint. And what to look for the SI joint? We have various x-ray grading for the SI joint. But to begin with, we should know about the pathology and the sequence of events that occur in the SI joint. So to begin with, there will be blurring of the cortical margin of the subchondral bone. So it will be followed by erosions and the sclerosis. Now as the erosion will progress, there will be first pseudo widening of the joint. Then at last there will be a fibrous and bony ankylosis at the joint. And the grading is the New York criteria. So in grade 0 it is normal, in grade 1 it is a minimal sclerosis. Then in grade 2 there is a definite sclerosis at the margins. Grade 3 is the formation of the erosions and the sclerosis, and grade 4 is the obliteration and the ankylosis. So this grading should be kept in mind as it will be used in the diagnostic criteria. Then there are various lesions that are found, that are named. So one of them is the Romanus lesion. So Romanus lesion is basically a reactive sclerosis. So what is Romanus lesion? It is a earliest change of the axial spondyloarthropathy. It occurs at the annulus insertion of the vertebral end plate, anterior or posterior vertebral body, and it results in the reactive sclerosis and erosion. So how does it look like? So Romanus lesions on X-ray MRI look like a reactive sclerosis at the margin of the annulus fibrosus on X-ray and MRI. So another important sign is the dagger sign, which is also because of the bamboo spine formation, because of the formation of the syndesmophytes. So it indicates a posterior interspinous and the supraspinous ligament ossification. The other sign is the Andersen lesion. So Andersen lesions in ankylosing spondylitis is basically a discovertebral lesion. So we have the three types of Andersen lesion. In type 1, it is the central portion of the discovertebral junction that is involved. In type 2, it is the peripheral portion of the discovertebral junction is involved. In the type 3, it involves the both peripheral and the central portion. So as seen in here X-ray, so in type 1, it is only the central portion of the discovertebral junction that is involved, while in type 3, both the central and the peripheral junction are involved of the discovertebral region. Then the other investigation that can be done are the CT, which is rarely done, and MRI can also be done to diagnose for the sacroiliitis basically. And bone scan is rarely done to look for the active lesion. Now coming upon to the various diagnostic criteria, how we will diagnose and confirm our diagnosis of ankylosing spondylitis. So there is a clinical and radiological criteria. So clinical criteria, we have a low back pain and stiffness which improves with activity and it is for more than 3 months. So this is one criteria. Second is the clinical criteria is the limited or reduced range of motion on lumbar spine in forward and the lateral bending. And then we have the third criteria is the limitation of the chest expansion relative to normal values for that age and sex. So these are the three clinical criteria. For radiological criteria, it can be a bilateral sacroiliitis which is of greater than grade 2. So grade 2 was the definite sclerosis, or it can be unilateral grade 3 or grade 4. Grade 3 was associated with erosions and sclerosis, and grade 4 was the enclosed joint. So these were the clinical and the radiological criteria. So to diagnose, so important to note that the diagnosis of the ankylosing spondylitis is made if the patient fulfills at least one radiological and one clinical criteria. So if the patient fulfills one radiological and clinical, so diagnosis can be made of ankylosing spondylitis. So another criteria that is very commonly used is the American criteria. So this criteria says that in patient with greater than 3 months back pain and age of onset is less than 45 years. So if the patient is having sacroiliitis on imaging and one of these spondyloarthritic features, which is the inflammatory back pain, arthritis, enthesitis, uveitis, dactylitis, psoriasis, patient is having good response to nucides, family history, HLA-B27 or elevated CRP. So if any of these features is associated with sacroiliitis on imaging, the patient can be classified or diagnosed as ankylosing spondylitis. Or it can be if the patient is having HLA-B27 positive, the patient should have at least two or more than two criteria to fit in the diagnosis of the ankylosing spondylitis. So this was all about the various diagnostic criteria that are used to diagnose the ankylosing spondylitis. So important to remember here is the symptoms, the various imaging techniques. So the various sacroiliac changes, grading of the sacroiliitis on SA joint. The modified New York criteria, which is clinical and radiological criteria. And the ASAS classification criteria. So in the coming video, in the part 3 we will discuss about the how to treatment of ankylosing spondylitis. Kindly comment down below any suggestions or any queries and keep supporting.